All right, welcome back to our holiday show and gift guide. The music you just heard is from the new Blackmore's Night album, Winter Carols. And we're going to go out with some of their music, too. Blackmore's Night, we have talked about before. They're kind of a sort of a medieval, modern medieval is kind of a genre, but it's really fun stuff. And this is their, they've released Christmas albums before, holiday albums, and these are just an amazing bunch of great Christmas carols and holiday tunes on here. So highly recommended, Winter Carols from Blackmore's Night. And we will play a little bit more at the end of the show. We got a giveaway as well, where we've had, you know, fewer giveaways under the pandemic constraints, but we do have some stuff to give away during the show. And we're going to talk about all these great gift suggestions, books and DVDs and CDs and Blu-rays and 4Ks and everything else. But Tim, we just in the last like 48 hours of recording this, we lost a couple of people.
Oh, yes.
I hate doing the obits, but especially for a holiday show. But who'd we lose?
Well, you know, Lena Wertmuller, of course, the wonderful Italian filmmaker. 93, I think it's
good life.
Good long one there. Quite a character. I never met her in my years. I worked right up to the end, but just really a seven beauties, of course.
First woman nominated for an Oscar.
For an Oscar, very thoughtful, about filmmaking, all kinds of stuff. And, you know, she was talking about women and cinema and directing and stuff like that 50, 60 years ago, Lena Wertmuller. So, gone and of course swept away. Beautiful movie too. So, you know, I mean, we talk about seven beauties, but she made a whole bunch of fantastic films.
Yeah.
Lena Wertmuller. So lost her, and literally today, if not maybe yesterday, maybe it was yesterday or something like that, but the monkey, Mike Nesbitt.
Mike Nesbitt.
One of the last two. I think Mickey Dolenz is the other one still.
Mickey's the last one, man. It's really sad. I posted a thing on Facebook. It's like we're down to, you know, two Beatles, one monkey, one BG, but we still have all of Apple. So I take a little bit of solace in that. But man, yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Mike Nesbitt was only 78, but really, I mean, he was always my favorite monkey because he was the funniest. Mm. He was the one who had the amazing comic timing. He was a legit songwriter, wrote a lot of their really good songs. And his aunt invented liquid paper, and he was independently wealthy when he inherited his aunt's estate. Didn't even need all that monkey money after all.
That was that's so fantastic. I love that story. And of course, he went into the film business.
He was
a fairly noted producer of, you know, of films, kind of, I guess, from through the 80s, 90s. He was there associated with Rhino Records and all, and when they were doing movies and stuff like that, you'd see him as executive producer.
And you know, he also was a pioneer in doing a video production that was not released to television or movies, but that went straight to video. I mean, he was a straight to video pioneer with Elephant Parts. If nobody's seen that, Elephant Parts is kind of this legendary, amazing hour long comedy and sketch comedy, like variety compilation, which has some of the funniest bits that you will ever see. And it could have been a weekly show. It could have been a weekly show like an SNL or any other, you know, variety or comedy show. But it wasn't. It was a one-off. He didn't want to do a whole show. He didn't want to do it, you know, episode after episode, season after season. He just wanted to do 1 hour of this stuff.
Yeah.
And then put it into the world. And that would never have been a business model in the 1970s. You couldn't have said, yeah, I just want to do a one-off. You know, they'd be like, no, we need a show every week.
Yeah.
We got to do, this is like, he's like, no. And once video came around and you were renting and selling videos, he's like, you know what? There's a market for this. I can just do my 1 hour of stuff, sell it on videotape and be done with it.
Yep.
And it's like, wow.
Yeah. There you go. So forward thinking about, so that's like 1981 that he did that. So just way ahead of his time and a really, really, really cool guy. So, you know.
Yeah. Anyway. All right. Well, let's jump into it. Let's start with some books, because we got a lot of great books here. I want to talk about things related. First of all, this really cool book by Phil Hall is called, you know, Christmas being a religious holiday first and foremost. I want to make mention of this book, Jesus Christ Movie Star by Phil Hall, which is not a huge book. It's, you know, it's only 154 pages long, but it is a really interesting book. And he runs through all these, not just, you know, Jesus movies, but the sort of the thematic strain of Jesus in the movies. It's a really, really interesting little book. I really do recommend it, especially if you're a fan of the genre, which I am. And he you know, it's a very thoughtful book, and it's kind of forward looking too. So
my movie Christ Jesus movie star. My movie Jesus, let me see. Willem Dafoe, really, yeah, in that Scorsese film. Yeah. He was a good Jesus. You know, he was a young Willem Dafoe. We hadn't seen a whole lot of him before. He had been around, you know, he had that sort of skeletal. So it's that good Jesus, Willem Dafoe. But I like my Jim Caviezel Jesus too, in Mel Gibson's movie.
I do too.
That's a solid Jesus. I do too. That's a solid movie.
He Jesus. Is. I am also very, very defensive of Jeffrey Hunter in King of Kings, which, you know, was mocked at the time. They called it I was a teenage Jesus. You know, they really made fun of it. I know Jeffrey Hunter, we prefer to think of him as Christopher Pike on Menagerie on Star Trek, the original Christopher Pike. But I thought he was very good in that. There have been a lot, and it's a really interesting area. It's a really interesting area. So this is a terrific book.
I don't know if it comes to any video Jesus, but I think it was Leon. Was it Leon in that Madonna video back in the 80s?
Yeah, yeah.
It was Leon, right?
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah,
yep, so, sure was. So
one,
sure was.
One good black Jesus.
And we've got the Gospel Collection on DVD, which we've recommended before. This is all four of the Gospel films, which were made a few years back. Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You can get that. That's from Lionsgate. That's on DVD. It's also a new Blu-ray and DVD compilation out called The Jesus Music, the soundtrack of a movement. And this is just, you know, a lot of, I don't want to call it so much faith-based, but it really kind of is. These are sort of faith-based artists, and you get a lot of really wonderful performances in here. Amy Grant has been a crossover, obviously, for many, many years, but also featured Michael W. Smith, Toby Mac, Kirk Franklin. So it's, you know, you get Newsboys, Skillet, Striper. Remember Striper, the heavy metal band with kind of a Christian theme to it. It's a lot, you know, this, so that's, you know, Amy Grant kind of anchors it. And then we also have highly, highly recommended. If you have not, you know, if you were a fan of this genre and these films in particular, the God's Not Dead films, all four of them, God's Not Dead, God's Not Dead 2, God's Not Dead, A Light in the Darkness, which is really interesting, by the way. And God's Not Dead, We the People, which is the most recent one that was done primarily during the pandemic. But you know, the faith-based market gets a bad rap sometimes. I think these movies in particular started on a little bit of a shaky foot. People kind of made fun of that first film, and then they got very philosophical and very reflective. Mm-hmm. And by the time you get to the third film, God's Not Dead, A Light in the Darkness, it's actually quite provocative and thoughtful, and has a lot of really interesting crossover questions and a lot of self-reflection. And the nice thing is they're not doing what Hollywood would do, which is make the same thing over and over and, you know, just for the sake of money. This is a franchise that exists because the filmmakers feel like they still have something to say. They're not exploiting this like a franchise. They're not just putting it out there because it's a brand. Mm. They really do have something new to say in each and every film. And so that's a good one to get, especially as a gift, you know, at Christmas time. God's Not Dead, the four movie collection, and very impressive what they did during the pandemic in We the People. They pulled that off. And then we also have this great book. You know, my daughter stopped watching Sesame Street a little bit too soon for my taste, because I was kind of enjoying watching it with her, to be honest. But The Unseen Photos of Street Gang, How We Got to Sesame Street, is the book. Yeah. And the Blu-ray is Street Gang, How We Got to Sesame Street. Yeah. And they do kind of go together. How We Got to Sesame Street is an absolutely terrific documentary. I mean, it is the whole story. Jim Henson's involvement, everyone who sort of helped kind of birth the idea, how it came out of 60s activism, how it kind of turned into a more crossover public television iconic show, the birth of the characters, the puppetry, everything about it. Very interesting. Particularly interesting to me, because I should point out, because shortly after I grew up on Sesame Street, I go to elementary school, and there's this girl 1 year older than I am in elementary school named Holly Robinson, whose dad is on Sesame Street. He's like the original Gordon on Sesame Street. And you're like, wow, Gordon's daughter is in school. That's kind of cool. Right. And so, you know, and at one point, which a few years later, I wound up on a television, a local television talk show with Holly, but that's another story I won't get into because it's kind of weird. But nonetheless, all of that is really, really a, it's a really wonderful story. It's just an absolutely wonderful story. Street Gang, how we got to Sesame Street, a great all-American story. And then you want to supplement that with The Unseen Photos of Street Gang, which is this beautiful coffee table book that just has these incredible, I mean, Tim, we can't put this on the podcast or not video, but let me just show you some of this. I mean, it's just beautiful.
Oh, it's
just
gorgeous.
Like these beautiful,
it's
just look at that. These just beautiful, it's just beautiful photos. It's not, there's no text.
Yeah.
You know, they're just, it's just page after page of like these beautiful black and white and color photos. And, you know, and then you have later on in the book, you have some, you know, a few, I mean, like after you'll have a few pages, like about Big Bird or whatever, but it's only a few pages. And then it's just a lot of photos.
Yeah. That's
and fantastic. Then a lot more photos. And it's just beautiful. Like, look at these great black and white photos of the camera and Big Bird and the actors. I mean, how great is that?
That's just amazing. Just amazing.
You're seeing how the show's made. You're seeing how the sausage is made. It's all
very behind the scenes.
It's absolutely beautiful. It's a coffee table book that won't bore the people who come to your house. Yeah. Everyone will look at this and go, oh, holy cow, I had no idea. And then you could also add to that a new Sesame Street DVD, the Sesame Street Wonderful World of Friends, which is, you know, just wonderful shows involving Elmo and Big Bird and Rosita. And it's all about friendship. And that's a nice thing for the kids in their stocking. Other books. You haven't seen Nightmare Alley yet, have you?
No, I haven't seen it yet. Guillermo.
Yeah, Guillermo. Because we talked about this at Halloween. Want to do another plug for Guillermo del Toro, the iconic filmmaker, and his work, which is this wonderful book on his movies in a slipcover, which will be obsolete in a minute and a half. Yeah. Because they kind of try to get out in front of it a little bit, but Nightmare Alley basically makes this book totally obsolete. but it's okay. It's okay. I don't want to say too much about Nightmare Alley. But the first hour of that movie is really long. Yeah. That's all. I'll just leave it there. Got another book here. Our good friend Tim Grierson, colleague of ours. Tim has a book out called This Is How You Make a Movie, which is a whole lot of great interviews with tons of filmmakers, Spielberg, Scorsese. He's separated the book into all of these different film techniques. Mm-hmm. And, like depth of field, for example. And he references these filmmakers in particular, interviews with them and quotes that they've given and things that he examines from their films. And he's put it all together in kind of a wonderful compendium of all the things that make filmmaking. So if you're looking for a book that's kind of, a practical breakdown of film technique, for example, let me get one here. Panning. All right. So just open it randomly to panning, moving the camera from a fixed point in order to take in all the action. Fair enough. And then he talks here in about how you hold on. Let me just get to the thing here. So he gets a whole bunch of different examples. Right. So, for example, in Paranormal Activity 3, he's got examples from The Last Picture Show, 1971, Peter Bogdanovich. The Lobster in 2015. And then he's got one here in Paranormal Activity 3. And you're like, well, that's really interesting. How do you do that? And so he's giving you all these different, these very, very different examples from different films of how a panning shot can be used. And he does all kinds of different techniques. Here's one of my favorite, chiaroscuro. You're like, what the hell's chiaroscuro? Yeah. Like, what's that? Well, that's a particular light and shadow technique. He talks about The Godfather, talks about Touch of Evil, goes into Night of the Hunter, gives you all these really, really great examples. So this is a wonderful book. Tim is an awesome guy. Yeah. He put a lot of work into this, and I tip my hat to him. It's well done.
Outstanding, outstanding. A must-have for any wannabe filmmaker or film student. I'll put it that way, a student of film.
Absolutely. Shooting Midnight Cowboy, Art, Sex, Loneliness, Liberation, and the Making of a Dark Classic by Glenn Frankel, who also wrote about The Searchers and High Noon. This is a wonderful making of book about Midnight Cowboy, which is just absolutely terrific. A fascinating, fascinating story. And then we also have Buzz, The Life and Art of Busby Berkeley, which was out a few years ago. This is now out in soft cover from the University Press of Kentucky, University of Kentucky Press. Mm-hmm. Wonderful story about Busby Berkeley, the great musical legend who had an unbelievably dark life outside of the musicals. We also talked about Making Ryan's Daughter, which is also going to shortly be coming out in American pressing. Meanwhile, there is the European pressing, David Lean's 1970 film, which took over a remote part of Western Ireland for one of the all-time most extraordinary production. I don't want to say catastrophe. It was just a production adventure over there. It was an amazing story. Making Ryan's Daughter by Paul Benedict Rowan. And then this book by Lars Nilsson and friends.
Oh, yeah.
Tim,
oh,
yes. Warped and Faded. Let's talk about Warped and Faded for a second. This is kind of an amazing thing. Weird Wednesday and the Birth of the American Genre Film Market.
Yeah. Really, really interesting story that is part biography. Tim League and his wife and others, who of course, ultimately founded the Alamo Draft House cinema chain, and where they sort of came from, and how at a point some 20 odd years ago, after having a cinema up in Bakersfield, they go to Austin and they set up this sort of art house cinema and have to figure out what they're going to show, and through all kinds of machinations, they end up showing these really sort of fairly obscure films about everything that you can possibly think of. We're talking about your sort of exploitation films from every genre, including black exploitation, chop shop films, you name it, but really, really super duper ultra obscure films. And collectively, this group of people put together this archive that became an actual archive of these movies from this week. It refers to the night of the week that they would show these crazy films, and it was very, very popular and went on for years and years and years. And this book pulls all of that material together into three interesting sections. The first being sort of biographical, the middle section being a bibliography of all of the films that they showed over that period of time. And then the third section, sort of breaking out the sort of really interesting films with great stories that made for some really interesting moments for Weird Wednesday. Man, it's a really, really neat book. I like it a lot.
It's a really neat book. It's called Warped and Faded, and it is such an interesting story. So if you're a serious genre or cult film fan, even if you're not, I mean, it's a great thing to put on the coffee table book, the coffee table as well. Soft cover, but it's definitely a coffee table book. Let's roll through some of the holiday themed stuff. Yeah. It's always a right time for a new It's a Wonderful Life release, so that is out once again. they find a new way of doing it every single time. So we've got a nice new kind of boxed set here, which includes some recipe cards from the official Bailey Family Cookbook, if you can believe that. That actually exists. So we got some recipe cards. You can start making some food while you watch the movie. It has all the original extras on it on HD. And then a nice the recipes are hilarious, actually. It's really a kind of a clever gimmick to try to sell it again. But a nice little addition to that is this DVD, The Real Bedford Falls, It's a Wonderful Life, The Town, The Movie, The Legend. And this is from Kino Lorber and Virgil Films, released just last year. And this is a really cool little 30-minute documentary that doesn't overstay its welcome, where they go to the real Bedford Falls, which is the setting of the movie, is kind of an amalgamation of a bunch of different places. Yeah. And so they go to Seneca Falls. They go to the It's a Wonderful Life Festival, and they go to the places to recreate a lot of, how do you recreate modern day Bedford Falls in America? And it's fun and it's sweet. Yeah. And it's a good thing to watch along with It's a Wonderful Life. It gives you a taste of how the film still kind of has a footprint in the culture today. It's really it's really very sweet. It's a nice little 30-minute. It, you know, would have been a great extra, but it's not an extra. So, you know, you can get it and make it furnish your own extra. We've got this thing called Pups Alone with Malcolm McDowell and Danny Trejo. Yeah. I know what you're thinking. I know what you're thinking, Tim. You woke up last night and you thought, damn it, why have Danny Trejo and Malcolm McDowell never been in a movie together? Well, and then you thought, in fact, you know what would make it even better? If we had Danny Trejo and Malcolm McDowell in the same movie with Jerry O'Connell, Jennifer Love Hewitt, Rob Schneider, and Dolph Lundgren. That would make a movie.
And apparently puppies, do I understand?
And dogs.
You know, all I know
and
is,
dogs.
All I know is somebody's going to kill a puppy. That's I'm just sure of it. Dolph Lundgren, Danny Trejo, somebody's going to kill a puppy. I just know it.
This is from Saban Films, where clearly people take a lot of drugs in the development department. And you know what? I mean, it's holiday time. I'm not going to be too hard on this thing. Malcolm McDowell and Danny Trejo are hardly even in this thing. They just bring some kind of weird star power. Mm. It's effectively Jerry O'Connell and Jennifer Love Hewitt with Rob Schneider. That's basically the group. Dolph Lundgren is sort of riffing on himself here. I mean, it's silly. It's cute. It'll be fun for the kids. Yeah. They'll have a blast with it. Also, what's really, really fun is the original Honeymooners special at Christmas Carol with Jackie Gleason.
Love that.
I mean, and this is great. This is just the Honeymooners clan doing their own version of Christmas Carol for live television. This was done in 1977. It still holds up. It's absolutely great. Jackie Gleason could do no wrong. There's a guy I'd just love to do a biopic about. But who would play him? Who could possibly do that? I don't know.
Yeah, the late Philip Seymour Hoffman would have been great.
He would have. Gosh, he would have nailed it, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Oh, what a tragedy.
Yeah.
Gosh, now I'm... Oh.
Missed out on that.
Well, anyway, that's really fun. As long as we're... We're in the Christmas animal mode. I'll throw a few more at you. we've got a gift from Bob, which is apparently based on a book series. Bob being a cat who actually plays himself in this thing. I don't know. He's a stray cat and he brings happiness and, you know, somehow they get the cat to behave. Charles Martin Smith, by the way, directed this. Very, very great old actor, who's directing stuff now. So it's kind of sweet. But here's the thing that amazes me with cats in movies, and especially this one. How do you train a cat,
man? Nah, doesn't happen.
I don't get it. I do not I just don't get how they make cats do things in movies. Dogs, I do. And then Brandi Roderick and Stephen Chase in Ace and the Christmas Miracle, which is kind of, you know, it's like it's a horse movie. The only reason to watch this is because Ace the horse speaks, and Ace's voice is John Lovitz.
Yeah, John Lovitz.
There's no other reason.
Tommy Flanagan. Yeah.
There's nothing else going on. Got a couple of steel books for holiday titles here. Sure. Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, which is basically Thanksgiving themed, but it still flies, right?
They're remaking that with Kevin Hart and Will Smith.
I wish they wouldn't. Do a different movie with those two actors. Seriously, don't redo Planes, Trains,
and Automobiles. Just decide to make a really funny movie with Kevin Hart and Will Smith, and you're one of them, or they hire somebody, and you write a movie, write us a movie. No reason whatsoever. There's nothing. It's perfectly fine, just the way it is.
Yeah.
Don't need it in black, and
the other thing too. If you're going to remake Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, you're clearly doing it because you feel you need the theme, you need the branding of the original thing to sell it. But wait a minute. Kevin Hart and Will Smith. That doesn't sell it by itself.
I think those two gigantic movie stars, you're good. And just write them their own, just like Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, 1987, I think it is. John Hughes, yep. Steve, and Candy.
It was an original film.
John Hughes, he sat down. He said, I'm going to write a movie. Put these two guys in. Somebody, we said it during Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
For what reason do we never do that anymore? Why is that no longer allowed? Why must everything be, okay, I'm on a tangent. I'll stop.
I know. I'm with you. And the other one, the other Steelbook, is the original Christmas specials collection. All five of the original great holiday favorites. Rudolph, the Red-Nosed Reindeer, Frosty, the Snowman, Santa Claus is Coming to Town, which we're going to watch tonight with my daughter, The Little Drummer Boy, and Cricket in the Hearth. That's it. They're great. The only thing that would have made this better would have been to throw in, Mr. Magoo's Christmas Carol. That would have worked for me too. But anyway, there's a bunch of great extras on here too. The Animagic World of Rankin Bass, who of course made all of these. We love the old Rankin Bass stuff. It's just fantastic. So this is a wonderful little look back at Rankin Bass and how they made all their animated and stop motion stuff. Thing here called TEAM Rudolph, Team Rudolph and the Reindeer Games, which is like a video storybook. It's okay. And then some original pencil tests for Frosty the Snowman, which are really cute. That's a great steel book. Yeah. These come out every year, but they haven't been out in a steel book before.
Yeah.
Tim, did you ever watch the Waltons?
Oh, are you kidding?
Were you a Waltons fan when you were kids?
Yeah, your first to last episode, all of them. John Boy, goodnight, John Boy, goodnight.
Oh my gosh. That was my father's upbringing. He used to love that show, and we watch all the time. And the original movie that launched that, which did not really have the original cast, I think Will Gear was in it, was called The Homecoming. Well, they've remade The Homecoming, so we now have The Waltons Homecoming, which is a new holiday movie. It's got like basically that original story done with a new and a younger cast, and. It still works.
Yeah.
It still works. It's still, you know, you still, it still works. It really does. I see that
Richard Thomas as Self is in this. Is that a framing thing that they're doing?
It's kind of. I will not get into the details of how that works. It ties it all together. It does tie it all together, kind of. But it's a lovely revisitation of the original story that launched the Waltons, and it's a lovely way of tying it together with its roots. Mm-hmm. It's just nostalgic and sweet, and it is a Christmas themed story. The Homecoming was always a Christmas themed story. And Earl Hamner, by the way, we should always point this out. Earl Hamner, who created the Waltons and was a great writer on a lot of TV shows. It's all about his life. Yeah. It was basically his story. It was
He's John Boy.
His upbringing. He's John Boy. Yeah. And Earl Hamner also wrote at least two really great Twilight Zone episodes. One of which is about the old guy and the dog mm-hmm. who die. That's the old hunter, the old hillbilly guy. Great episode. Great episode.
Yeah.
So and then lastly here, we've got a couple of PBS titles, 20 Snowy Stories, and then the PBS Kids Christmas Collection, both these PBS Kids, 20 Snowy Stories and the Christmas Collection. This is just pretty much everything that they could come up with that has snow in it. Every show from Caillou to Dinosaur Train, Daniel Tiger, Arthur, Let's Go Luna, Wild Kratts, Peg Plus Cat. Pinkalicious. I mean, all these shows, some of them I can't stand, and some of them I think are pretty cute. So look, if you've got a kid and you just need to keep our kids and you just need to keep them busy with a lot of safe PBS stuff, there you go. That's for the most part pretty safe. And then we've got the Christmas Collection, which is all of these kinds of very specific Christmas romance and kind of silly comedy movies that are set in different locations and different. Anyway, this is how they go. Christmas in the Smokies is one. Christmas in the Wilds is another. Christmas on the Coast, a little more cosmopolitan. Christmas in the Pines. There you go. And then lastly, Christmas in the Rockies.
Mm.
You've heard of almost nobody in any of these. These are all actors who are, they made the casting call and they're on their way up and they're just trying to build a resume.
Fantastic.
And, the writing is it's fine. This is from Imagicom. They're the ones that make this. It's all designed to be very Hallmarky, very Lifetime, very safe, but, it's a nice collection. So check it out if you want to kind of build a library of that stuff. Christmas in the Smokies, in the Wilds, on the Coast, in the Pines, and in the Rockies. All right, Tim, where do we turn next? We can go to the box sets. We can go to classic 4K TV new movies.
What do we got here? I'm looking at TV. We got a lot of Star Trek, I see.
Yes, we do. A whole lot.
So this original series, what is that, like a new set of Blu-ray or something? What do we got?
This is Star Trek, the original series. This is steelbooks of the original series, the first three seasons, mm-hmm. seasons one, two, and three, in a nice cardboard sleeve. Very nice set. They've been released before, obviously. These are the same remasters that we've had released before, with all of the special features that you've had before, which are amazing. There's no reason going through all the special features, but they're in steelbooks. Mm-hmm. So if you kind of want to upgrade, get rid of those old plastic cases that take up maybe too much space.
I know. Yeah, with all the colors. Oh, yeah, that's the level.
They're big. Maybe you want to slim down. Maybe you want steelbooks. So we got a nice, beautiful box set with all the steelbooks in it, and it's really gorgeous. It's heavy, but it's nice. And you know, sometimes heavy is really good because you know not giving away secrets here, but if you want somebody to think you've given them a really good gift, but you haven't spent much money, you want to try to get weight to offset what you didn't spend money on, right? So. If you get a good deal on this, it's heavy. And someone will pick it up and go, ooh, you must have spent a lot of money on something this heavy. So it's an old Christmas tree.
Discovery, one through three, seasons one through three. Discovery is, I like it more than you. It's sort of getting there. I kind of dig it a little bit. But what do you got, one through three? Anything good come with that?
No, not really. I just want to say, I'm not going to be a grouch or a Grinch or a Scrooge on Christmas. Go for it. Discovery, one through three. It's a great show, even if there are characters with too much makeup. I'll live with it.
What a D on a Star Trek series is nutty. Superman animated series.
Yeah. Beautiful Blu-ray of Superman, the complete animated series. This is there have been a million Superman animated shows. This is the more recent one. This is not the Fleischer Superman or anything like that. Mm-hmm. This is the one from 25 years ago. This is the late 90s version.
That's the one that I actually engaged even more than the Fleischer. So the Fleischer's from the, what were they from, like the 50s? Oh, geez, maybe?
Dude, like 50s, I or think. 50s, like 40s, you 50s, know, yeah.
They're beautiful.
Yeah.
I love them. They had this sort of, but you know, the Superman that I watched more of is that Superman from the 90s.
Well, it's beautiful. It's a 25th anniversary. It's a 6-disc edition, and it's got commentaries on 4 episodes, 5 featurettes, and it's some really fun stuff. The commentaries, I listened to 2 of the commentaries, and they're really good. They do what the commentaries are supposed to, which is they get into the stories, they get into the animation, they get into the all the stuff you want them to get into. And you know, 25 years ago, this show holds up. I got to admit, the animation still really, really works.
Yeah, great really narratives. Does. Great narratives in that series too. They were very contemporary. The narratives in that Superman series. What's in that Snoopy collection?
Snoopy collection is so much fun. We just watched Charlie Brown Christmas a couple of nights ago, and then we tried to watch the second Charlie Brown Christmas special. Mm. Not good. Yeah. Not good. Really not good at all. No, this is all 4 of the kind of classic feature movies featuring Snoopy. A Boy Named Charlie Brown, Race for Your Life Charlie Brown, Bon Voyage Charlie Brown, and Snoopy Come Home. Okay. And I got to be honest, A Boy Named Charlie Brown and Snoopy Come Home are kind of the 2 all-time classics. Oh, yeah. Those are the ones that really, really capture everybody. These things also totally hold up. They're all rated G. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful Peanut stuff. And worth pointing out that the other 2, Race for Your Life Charlie Brown and Bon Voyage Charlie Brown, never, ever, ever been on Blu-ray before. So this is all 4 of the feature-length Charlie Brown movies together in a Blu-ray set for the very, very first time. It's really, really great, and they look beautiful.
That's nice.
Tim, Yellowstone. We have beautiful sets for the first 3 seasons of Yellowstone. The show is still going, of course. And I know people who've worked on it, and they really like working on the show. But this is seasons 1, 2, and 3 on Blu-ray. Beautiful special Dutton Ranch decal editions, beautifully packed up as a gift from Paramount. Special features on here that are really, really nice. Go all the way inside. A lot of backs behind the scenes stuff. But ultimately, This is still kind of Dallas Dynasty-ish, isn't it?
Dallas Dynasty with a little touch of Falcon Crest. Talk about there. Yeah. What was his name? Earl Hamner. Earl Hamner, Falcon Crest. That was one of his. It's right there. Yellowstone, which is interesting to me, but just sort of like set in the West. There you have it.
Who would have thought that Kevin Costner would have a late stage career renaissance? Yeah. As the patriarch of a hit TV show.
He had to grow into it. It's a really amazing thing, these cats that we followed. Our first Kevin Costner, I think it's his hand or something in The Big Chill.
He's barely in it.
And then Silverado, Lawrence Kasdan's film. He's the younger brother of who is it? Scott... Anyway, that wonderful Western, Danny Glover.
But then again, remember, I grew up thinking that Barbara Stanwyck was that sweet white-haired lady on The Big Valley,
as opposed to that vixen from Double Indemnity. That's right. Wearing those fools is kind of nutty. What, dude? Thundar the Barbarian again? I don't know.
Oh my god!
In the eighties. In the early 80s, I had a thing. I was a grown man in the early 80s. In the early 80s, I had a thing for all these cartoons. What Thundar the Barbarian are we talking about?
Thundar the Barbarian, the complete series, the original Hanna-Barbera classic, this is now part of the Hanna-Barbera Classic Collection, the complete series of Thundar the Barbarian. It's pretty much like all those other Hanna-Barbera shows from that time, but it's great nostalgia, and it's out now, and it's a lot of fun. I wish it were on Blu-ray. It's not. It's DVD. Yeah. But that's fine. If you want to introduce your kids and go, this is a cartoon from my era. Yeah. If you want to be that person over the holidays, you can go to town with this. I mean, what I like about this was that most of these other shows were very sci-fi.
Yeah.
And this was more fantasy. This was more kind of...
This is as close to that Cats that Rob Marshall did
It's kind of more Conan. Yeah. It's more like a Conan the Barbarian E-Man, for kids.
Masters of the Universe.
He-Man, some of that.
I Dream of Genie.
Blu-ray!
Oh my god. Bewitched, yes, love me some Bewitched with the two Darrens and all that. But and I know it may not be popular to this day, but I absolutely loved I Dream of Jeannie, was totally in love with Barbara Eden.
I cannot recommend this show enough. I have shown a couple of these episodes to my daughter, so I've tried to get her, because she still loves cartoons, and I've tried to get her a little bit more into the TV shows I grew up on. Haven't gotten to Gilligan's Island yet. Haven't gotten to the Beverly Hillbillies. We're still, working our way there. But I have shown her the Munsters, mm-hmm. which she thinks is ridiculously funny. And I've shown her I Dream of Jeannie, and she loves Jeannie. She loves Jeannie. And the beautiful thing here, I know a lot of people try to be in like, oh, it's not feminist. He owns her. And there's a like, no. Let me explain to you. Jeannie owns Tony. Yeah.
That's the thing twist that people of the show. Never get when they see the show. Jeannie's running every fucking thing. Whatever Jeannie wants to happen, at the end of the day, that's what's going to happen. Tony Absolutely. Says no. Jeannie says yes. Blinks her eyes and the shit goes down. Or whatever. That's the way that show works. Who's in charge? Jeannie's in charge.
It's still so much fun. And the beautiful thing I have to say about this, so the original release of this on DVD came in this kind of elaborate box set that was shaped like the bottle and all this stuff. But the first season was all in color. It was all colorized. Whereas the first season was originally black and white. Yeah. Same thing with Gilligan's Island. A lot of those shows had a first season in black and white and then went color in the second season. And this is another of them. And this has the original episodes of the first season in black and white, which is great. It's 12 discs. It's from Mill Creek.
Yeah, because you almost never see them.
It's fantastic. It's all on Blu-ray, and we're going to be watching a lot of this over the holidays. Going to be watching a lot. And, got to remember, too, Tony and Jeannie eventually got married.
Yeah.
So Jeannie wound up getting pretty much everything she wanted out of the
movie. Yeah. I'm telling you, if you want this, it's the exact opposite, actually. The Ricardos is one of the big films that and I've been talking about it, and we have our issues and whatnot. We won't kill it for people at the moment. But the show itself, I Love Lucy. I was never a fan. I was never a fan of the show. I was never a fan of Lucy. I was never a fan of the dynamic happening in that show. It seemed to me that Lucy was all about undermining Ricky. It's like, Ricky's trying, yeah, look, I got this show, I'm trying to do this thing, and Lucy's like, I want to be in the show. He's like, but you can't sing, you can't dance, you can't do anything. And you know what I'm like? It's like, look, it's not my fault that you don't have any talent. He goes to Hollywood, she undermines, almost ruins his Hollywood. Lucy, Jeannie was like, look, Tony, I'm a fucking genie.
Yeah.
Bruh.
Yeah.
Wait, I can make this shit happen. What do you need, baby? Yeah. What do you need? And Tony's like, no, genie, no, genie, no, genie. It's like, oh my God. And she has to work around him to help him. Let me help you help yourself, Tony.
One of my favorites is the episode with Boyce and Hart. And Boyce and Hart were, of course, the great songwriting and performing duo, wrote a lot of, as long as we're talking about Passing and Mike Nesmith, Boyce and Hart wrote a lot of great Monkees tunes. Yeah. And they have that same vibe. It's a similar thing. And it's where Boyce and Hart guested as a couple of guys that Jeannie blinks together to form a band.
Yeah.
And right. I mean, and it's really, really, really fun. It's a terrifically fun episode, with some great cameos in it.
Yeah.
And then we've also, I mean, just, you gotta get this. I Dream of Jeannie on Blu-ray. Come on, make yourselves happy. Yeah. Make the family happy. Two more Ultraman, shows from the ongoing series releases from Mill Creek. Ultraman Dyna, the complete series plus all the specials, and Ultraman Tiga complete series plus all the specials. I am so far out of the loop at this point. All I know is that the heads are like different shapes and have, you know, different forms on them. That's the only way I couldn't tell the difference between any of them. You know, what Ultraman is a Dyna, is a Tiga versus a, you know, a Mega versus a Frieza. I have no idea, but you know what? I don't need to know, because they didn't make these for me. They made these for all you Ultraman lunatics out there. So go pop these under the Christmas tree, or in, you know, Hanukkah's over now, so we can't really sort of suggest that. But there you go.
Yeah.
And then a couple other shows here. Complete series of Hawthorne with Jada Pinkett Smith, and the complete series of Younger, which is a Darren Star show that tried to sort of capture the
sex the of spirit the city of the, sort of
yeah.
thing. Yeah.
Yeah. But, it didn't quite catch on. You know, Tony Winter Sutton Foster is the star of Younger. And I think she's still going to come on, but, you know, there's like she's 40 and she's trying to be 20, and there's a whole like little age gimmick in it, but I mean, she's very good. But you know, for some reason, did you watch any?
Oh yeah, you looked at everything you said. Plus, that show just looked cheap. You know, you go back, you look at those Sex in the Cities.
Yeah, there's
production value in the. You know, I mean, you're in Manhattan and all that stuff in the first place. But that show looked like it cost $1.95.
And
with a bunch of bad acting, a bunch of bad actors, and these sort of been through the ringer sort of Darren Star stories. I agree completely on that one.
And Hawthorne didn't run for very long, 30 episodes, but Jade is very good
It's a damn good show and should have ran longer. Because Younger, I think that ran 3 or 4 seasons.
Dude, Mark Anthony's an actor on this show.
Yeah.
Like, people don't realize that Mark Anthony, the singer, became an actor on a medical show and is really good at it.
Yeah, Mark Anthony was always a good actor. Yeah. Mark Anthony's in Bringing Out the Dead, I think.
Oh, he is.
Tiny little role, but he's just fantastic at it. And then he started hanging around with Jennifer Lopez, and there you go.
She's back with Ben.
Yeah, that's what happens with all that. It's funny that we've gone through all of that. Where are we going now?
Let's hit up some real quickly, just some of the new films that are out this week. This isn't Christmas stuff, but it's worth mentioning because they're new and maybe somebody who wants it as a gift. Mm. Paul Schrader's new movie, The Card Counter.
Yeah, actually.
Produced by Martin Scorsese, starring Oscar Isaac and Tiffany Haddish and Ty Sheridan. All very, very good. It's kind of a classic gambling theme, Paul Schrader, metaphor for life, the dark edges. And, it's really quite good. And I think Ty Sheridan is very, very good in it. Oscar Isaac's very good. They're in a bunch of movies this season. Ty Sheridan's also in the, In the Tender Bar, the George Clooney film. Yeah. I don't know. Have you gotten around to seeing that?
Yeah, I got it over there. I'm gonna pull that one out.
Watch it. Let me know what you think of it. I watched that a couple of nights ago too. Mm-hmm. I really enjoyed it. I think Ty Sheridan's quite good in it. Totally different. Okay. And he's totally different in this. So the Card Count, the Paul Schrader movie.
I'm trying to decide whether the business of Ben Affleck in all of that. We were just joking about it, you know. Jennifer Lopez through
Ben is really good in the Tender Bar. He's shockingly good. I mean, I was shocked how much I liked
you know,
because I mean, I'm usually ripping on.
I've been in and out with Ben Affleck for a long time now, which is kind of funny. But every now and again, he's really, really good. I didn't need that last duel thing.
That's a problem. But
what are you gonna, Oh, Henry, did you see that one?
Yeah, that dude. I really like this. This was sort of a surprise for me.
I liked it better. As Westerns go, it's just sort of Western, and you got Tim Blake Nelson, who's this farmer, this everyday farmer guy, and then your mud farmer. He's got this young son. And they run across this guy who has this money and is involved with these other bad guys, you know, Stephen Dorff and all that and all this stuff. But, you know, it has a sort of it lives in the same space as Unforgiven in a certain way in terms of those characters, you know, that Clint Eastwood character in Unforgiven. And except that Clint Eastwood guy in Unforgiven, it's, you know, 6 foot whatever Clint Eastwood is, you know, was in 1990, whatever. And he's this guy and you know, and he's in Tim Blake Nelson is this very slight little bitty guy. Yet in this who was a scary man back in the day. And Tim Blake is able to evoke a really believable guy, this old Henry guy. And you look at this little guy and you think, you know what? I don't want to fuck with this guy. Tim Blake generates that. And then he actually plays it. He plays it in this fairly, you know, taut, and bloody, pretty bloody, Western. I think it's so good work. I like it. I'm glad you liked it too.
Yeah, I did. I thought it was really terrific. And I don't want to rip on Clint because I'm being nice. You know, but Cry Macho is also out. Not my favorite Clint film. No. I will be honest, but I give him credit for making it in his 90s. I hope it's not his last film. I kind of want a better film than Cry Macho. The character in the book apparently is in his 40s or something, and Clint's in his 90s, and there's a romance, you know, with this Mexican lady. And I mean, the whole story of it, where he's hired to go and get this guy's son back over the border, who's, you know, like he's an old horse trainer, right? And the guy he works for has a son who's half American, half Mexican, who's with his mom in Mexico. And Clint has to be the guy who kind of goes and brings him back across the border and, you know, so he can have a normal life as opposed to whatever dysfunctional life he has with his borderline organized crime mom. Anyway, so it's kind of a road trip. Doesn't really work. It feels loose and sloppy. The scenes where Clint is like riding a horse and breaking it, where you have a long shot of somebody else riding the horse, and then you cut to these close-ups of 93-year-old or 92-year-old Clint, clearly not on a horse, not working for me. But I admire him for actually giving it the old college
try. Well, we had an interesting conversation about it when it came out. And what I think I admire is the fact that when Clint Eastwood wakes up every day, in his mind, he's 19 years old, and he's Clint fucking Eastwood, and he can do whatever the hell he wants. He has been for 90 some odd years. And more, you know, look, that's an easy thing to sort of like poke an old guy about. But more and more, I'm deeply appreciating that. Clint plainly is not waking up every day thinking, oh, I'm 93 and there's a bunch of shit I can't do. he don't do that. And I'm thinking Clint might have it right.
Yeah. You may be too. All right. And then we've got some animated stuff real fast. Paw Patrol, the movie. Oh, yeah. You know, if you like the TV show, you're going to love the movie. There's really nothing I can tell you about this. It's the same animation. It's just more of it. And then this little animated feature called Mosley, which is really sweet. Did you see Mosley?
Oh yeah, I saw Mosley. We had a little hesitation there. Yeah, I saw Mosley. Look, it's an interesting film, but It's this whole sort of slave narrative in it, but it's
that's true.
It's in the guise of these creatures that don't actually exist.
I like the animation and I like the voice casting.
Lucy
Lawless and John Rhys Davies, who always has this wonderful, wonderful voice. It's a thing. It's from a company called Hoo Hoo.
Yeah, is that right? What is it like? Yeah, I think it's like New Zealand or something like that.
And then Mitchells versus the Machines, which I do not like. Everyone else does.
Too much. Too much. Too fast. It never stops. And I just can't deal with that. As opposed to Bell, I think we talked about Bell. This lovely sort of floaty animation.
I'd like the slower. This thing's way too frenetic for me. But I have a feeling it's going to be really in the running. I mean, it's the people who did, the Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse movie. It's Phil Lord and Christopher Miller, who of course did the Lego movies, were key creative personnel on it. So it's got all of that freneticism. But if that stuff works for you, it doesn't work for me. We have three kind of interesting newish movies to just also finish out with here. One is Dear Evan Hansen.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not particularly a fan. A lot of people are. We got a lot of musicals this year. I'll let you talk about Dear Evan Hansen.
The problem of Dear Evan Hansen, unfortunately, is that what's his name, who's playing the lead in that that movie? I forget his name, but he played the role on Broadway.
Oh, Ben Platt. Platt.
Thank you. He played the role on Broadway, and when he played the role on Broadway, he was somewhere near the correct age to play this. By the time we get to this movie, he's 30, and he's supposed to be playing a 17-year-old, and he's playing against a bunch of people who can get away with playing 17, and he can't. He just can't. It's not his fault. It doesn't make him bad. He has a beautiful singing voice. I really love his voice, very pleading and lovely. And the story is what the story is. The problem of the movie is that Ben Platt is 30.
Yeah.
And that's just all there is to it.
Well, it is one of many musicals you can choose from. We got a few musicals we're going to make mention of here shortly. And then we also have this really interesting, I want to say like one from the heart type film called Coppelia. It's a Blu-ray and CD, Blu-ray DVD combination. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of like a pseudo animated mocap Fantasia. And it's a bit of a silly premise. There's almost no way to describe this, that there's this, it's almost like a matrixy kind of thing. Like this surgeon, it's going to sound really dumb, but there's this surgeon who sort of hypnotizes this whole town. And Coppelia is sort of a Pygmalion robot woman creation. And it's a bit of a Frankenstein thing kind of going on too. It's very strange, almost impossible to describe. Yeah. Just think about a mocap One from the Heart.
Yeah.
That's sort of what's going on here. And it's the star of it, Mikaela de Prince, I think.
Yeah.
Who was in Lemonade, Beyonce's thing? She's absolutely amazing.
Oh, she's lovely. She's
a beautiful dancer. Beautiful she's dancer. An incredible dancer.
There's a lot of ballet and modern dance.
It's really nice
in the piece. So it's just lovely.
It's the dance that you're watching it for. It's her ballet, her motion. She's just absolutely wonderful. And then you also have Mark Duplass and Natalie Morales in Language Lessons, which is cute and sweet.
Natalie directing.
Yeah, Natalie directed it. It's they wrote it together. It's a nice little small kind of two-person relation-ish thing, and I thought it was nice. It was nice to have one of these kinds of movies again, a low-budget film that's about relationships. It's funny and it's not overly dark and edgy. So that was good. Shall we roll through the 4Ks? Because some of these we talked about before, but these are all, I think everybody, if you didn't have a 4K last year, if you didn't have a 4K player, if you didn't have a 4K television, a lot of people probably do this year, and you're going to want to start to say, okay, now what can I get that looks better than just a regular Blu-ray? So let's go through them.
Well, let's might as well start with the biggie, No Time to Die.
No Time to Die, man. If the you know, as long as we're on the James Bond thing, hold on, let me pull it out here. All right, No Time to Die. It's finally out. It felt like it just came out a second ago, and now it's on 4K, and you can round out the rest of your Bond thing. Boy, I'll tell you, Tim. You know what's more impressive than the 4K on this is the audio.
Oh, really?
It's like they channeled 50% of the audio to the subwoofer. it's unreal. It is seriously unreal. I threw this thing on. I was like, holy cow. Like, yeah, you know, the plaster is going to start to come down. The neighbors are going to complain. It was a thing. Yeah, even when people are just talking, it sounds like Daniel Craig could just be talking and half of his voice is coming out of the subwoofer. It's really kind of gnarly, But you know, your thoughts on the film generally?
A good summation of this Daniel Craig era, I guess you would say, of the Bond films. It's a little long, but that's okay. I didn't mind. There are a few things that just bug a guy personally about it, you know, but I don't want to give away any narrative, so I'll let that go. What I love about it is Ana de Armas.
She's so good.
She just walks away with it. And good on Daniel Craig for you know, quote unquote, letting her. You know, and yeah. just baby, take me wherever you want to go. And she puts that white dress. Oh. And she's funny and she's sexy. And you believe all of her action abilities. You know, she owns it all completely, and she's just the most delightful thing in the movie. And I kept thinking to myself, you know, because they're going to reboot the Bond series, of course. I kept thinking to myself, you know, okay, fine, whatever, do whatever you want with that, but you can do anything with this character here that you want.
Spin her off.
You've given yourself a wonderful.
I'm there.
So yeah, that's
I'm there.
That's what I think about that.
Some wonderful extras here. The anatomy of a scene on here is really, really good as well. And some other really nice featurettes that kind of tie up the Daniel Craig era.
He was a good Bond.
He was a good Bond.
You have these people arguing, best Bond. Who's your best Bond? Look, they're all good Bonds. They're all good. George Lazenby, great Bond. There are no bad Bonds. Yep. It just depends on the nature of the Bond movie that you like, the kind of Bond movie. My favorite, I'm a Roger Moore man. I just happened to be a Roger Moore man. Sean Bridget was a Sean Connery man, girl. I'm a Roger Moore man. I like that Bond. I like what that Bond is doing. That Bond is a secret agent and loving it. Just having a good time being a sneaker agent. Fun, Duran Duran, you know, Grace Jones. He's just having a fabulous time being a secret agent. He's not particularly angry.
Terrific time.
You know, he never kills anybody unless they try to kill him first. He's that Bond, and that's why I love him.
I'm with you. We've got two giveaways right now, both of them 4K UHD. We have reviewed them before, and we are going to be in a position to give away one apiece. The Icons of Horror on 4K, which we covered on our Halloween show, and Inglourious Basterds, the Quentin Tarantino film Inglourious Basterds, both of them on 4K UHD. We're giving away one apiece. Send emails to gods@digigods.com or gods@cinegods.com. Put Icons in the subject line for Icons of Horror. Put Quentin in the subject line for the other. Icons and Quentin, and Quentin will get you entered for the random selection of Inglourious Basterds on 4K. Icons will get you entered in the Icons of Horror 4K, and we will pick a winner by the 20th. It's not going to get to you necessarily in time for Christmas, but we'll let you know if you won, and we will get those off ASAP. So The 20th is the deadline for that, December 20th. Icons for Icons of Horror and Quentin for Inglourious Basterds. Tim, we also have all four Indiana Jones movies on 4K.
Sweet.
The new one, not directed by Spielberg. James Mangold is directing the new one, so that's not going to quite be canonical. Also, I think, isn't Harrison Ford now older than Sean Connery was when he played Harrison Ford's dad?
Yeah, and then what would that have been, the third film?
The third one, yeah.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right.
I think I have a problem with that.
Well, you know, I wish Sean was still around to be in this one. And then that would have been really, really wicked cool. But, you know, not going to happen.
Based on the actual original timetable, this new film should be taking place in 1977, which means in theory, Indy could be going to the theater to watch Harrison Ford play Han Solo.
That would be awesome.
If I had green light power, I'd insist that be in the script.
Of course, Indiana Jones would never go to a science fiction.
No, he sure would not. If they wait a few years, he could go and see the original Indiana Jones movie.
That guy looks just like me.
Isn't that a weird thought? That we're now making an Indiana Jones movie that is as far from Raiders of the Lost Ark, almost as Raiders of the Lost Ark was, from the year in which it takes place. Yeah.
Wow.
Kind of crazy.
Yeah, man. Oh, wow.
So, anyway, these all look beautiful. We actually just watched the first one the other day. Let my daughter see the original Raiders of the Lost Ark all the way through. Mm-hmm. Totally dug it. Totally dug it. So we're getting there. Well,
that second one, the guy pulls the heart out of that was the thing at the time. You know, everybody was like, this is not our, you know, Siskel and Ebert and everybody.
It's what gave us our PG-13, yeah. Unfortunately. Yeah.
You know, and but now you see that and you're like, it's not a real heart.
Well, we talk about Star Trek. We also have previously reviewed the Star Trek original 4-movie collection on 4K UHD. That is still something you should really, really consider. I wish it had 5 and 6 on it. I don't know why they cut it off at 4. Nonetheless, even though I really quite like 5 and 6, I understand that 1 through 4 is kind of an arc. It's sort of its own self-contained story arc, so that's apparently what they're going for. You know, look, I love the original Star Trek motion picture. It's sort of 2, 3, and 4 are the story arc, but I still love motion picture.
I loved it too, but at the time, people were like, you know, because they wanted an action film, and Robert Wise didn't make an action film. He made a cerebral sort of thinky sort of film, you know. So.
Because that's what Gene Kelly wanted to write. Or Gene Roddenberry. Roddenberry. That's what he wanted to write. He wanted to do something thinking. You know what else? Tim, Mad Max Anthology on 4K. I've been waiting for this for so, so long. This is every Mad Max film from the original 1979. This has been hard to do because the rights are sort of all over the place. But 1979 Mad Max, The Road Warrior from 1981, Thunderdome from 85, and Mad Max Fury Road from 2015. All of them together in one 4K set. Plus Movies Anywhere code. You can't go wrong. Someone's going to be very, very happy to receive this at Christmas time. Very happy. George Miller, man, when we gave him the award at the last dinner, I just went up to him in his bomber jacket and gave him a hug. I couldn't believe I was hugging the man who made Mad Max, which I loved that movie. And I was a kid in junior high. And here I am hugging the man. Such a life highlight. So that's the Mad Max Anthology. Here's a few others real quickly. We also talked about Beverly Hills Cop and Top Gun on previous shows, on both of them on 4K. We want to recommend those as well. The Top Gun is in a steelbook. Yeah. Eddie Murphy and Beverly Hills Cop still totally holds up, Tim.
Funny. You know,
it's just wrong.
He was still on Saturday Night Live when he made that movie. You know, he was on Saturday Night Live for a little while longer. So you know, he was one of those guys who managed to make that pop into movie stardom while, you know, not from TV, but while still on TV.
Very true. We've also talked about the 4K releases, and we previously talked about Dune simply as a Blu-ray, but we did get finally the 4K of David Lynch's Dune, which is 4K Ultra HD. It looks freaking gorgeous. Nice contrast with the current Denis Villeneuve Dune.
Timothy Chalamet.
They each have their place. Yeah. It's an interesting contrast. But Tremors and Dune, both of which have kind of something in common in the giant sandworm thing. make for kind of a great Arrow 4K twofer. So give that some thought. Arrow really went to town. Tons of extras on both of these. David Lynch's Dune and the original Tremors, both of them 4K Ultra HD, great box sets with booklets. Guns of Navarone.
Yeah.
Guns of Navarone and The Outsiders are both new on 4K. I want to give those a recommendation as well. Tim, The Outsiders is really interesting. This is The Outsiders, the complete novel, which is the new Coppola re-edit of this thing. He keeps tinkering with his old movies. Yeah. Cotton Club, Apocalypse,
yeah, Redux,
all of these, and now we have The Outsiders. Did you see the recut of this?
I haven't seen the recut, no. Now, what do you think?
It's better.
Oh, well,
It's interesting. I was suspicious. I thought he's going to do what he did with Apocalypse, which is add in a bunch of stuff that he's having second thoughts about.
Print.
No, it really is. It's better. And the theatrical version's on here too, but I think it's better. I really do. I think this is a better film.
Yeah, yeah.
So
that's the film.
And it broke.
They gave us.
It broke a lot of young.
Oh, actors. Yeah. I was going to say. Yes, yeah, so it gave us C. Thomas and Matt and Ralph Macchio and just a whole bunch of Emilio,
yeah. Patrick Swayze.
It's just ridiculous.
Young Tom Cruise, yeah. Man. It's Matt Dillon. Ralph Macchio, Diane Lane. I mean, it was quite a cast. You look at this, you're like, holy cow, that's really, really impressive.
But what's interesting, though, it was a flop in 83. That movie was a flop in 83. Bat and Rumblefish, he had that sold a little run of these movies that are classic now. But at the time, none of those movies made a nickel.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's quite a bit, you know, his complete novel version of it, and you know, Hinton, S.E. Hinton's novels were kind of a big deal when we were kids. I don't know if you read any of them, but I was really, it was like, I was kind of surprised when I was a kid that, oh, this is recommended reading for my age, because this is a little gritty, but it was very good, and it's 20-some minutes longer. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's almost a half an hour longer. It's a lot more. It's a denser, the character development is stronger. It's just a more grown-up film.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping maybe he does that with Rumblefish. I think there's a better cut of Rumblefish in there somewhere, too. Guns of Navarone, Gregory Peck, David Niven, Anthony Quinn, classic old war movie on 4K UHD, also with Movies Anywhere code. This is from Columbia through Sony Pictures. All the extras on here are in HD. They're not in 4K. So you get basically a movie in 4K and then a bunch of featurettes and behind the scenes stuff and some commentaries and all that stuff. That's all on just HD. So don't be deceived and think that you're getting everything on 4K. But the movie is still really gorgeous. Mm. I mean, it's a great, great widescreen war film. From 1962, same year as Lawrence of Arabia. Yeah. I got no complaints.
Yeah. I love J. Lee Thompson. Love J. Lee.
It's good stuff. So anyway, Guns of Navarone. Couple here from Kino. Actually, three from Kino. Three 4Ks. Kino's doing a lot more 4Ks these days. These are the three that I think really, really stand out recently. Mel Brooks' Spaceballs. Underrated Mel Brooks movie. Yeah. Sergio Leone's The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, mm-hmm. which is still as great as it ever was, with Clint much better than he is in Cry Macho. Yeah. And the Oscar-winning Silence of the Lambs, Jonathan Demme.
Yeah.
And we have talked about all three of these previously as well, loaded with special features. The two commentaries on The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, and the Silence of the Lambs from Tim Lucas, who does a very, very good, very good job. A lot of other featurettes and documentaries and outtakes and things on here. And then audio commentary with Mel Brooks on Spaceballs, which is a totally crazy, wacky, funny commentary. Mel is such a showman, and there are even some other little funny stuff on here, which is film flubs and this thing, watch Spaceballs in ludicrous speed, which is kind of silly, but still funny. And then a great conversation between Mel Brooks and co-writer Thomas Meehan, which I thought was quite illuminating. Hmm. 4K Cinema Paradiso, Giuseppe Tornatore.
Man.
What
a moment.
Does this film hold up?
It absolutely does. It absolutely does. It's still beautiful. Still bring you to tears. It's absolutely, you know, particularly for cinephiles, but just as a drama, it absolutely holds up. I loved it.
Well, we get both versions of this as well, the original two-hour version and then the nearly three-hour version, which was the one that Tornatore originally made, but Harvey Weinstein made him cut down because he wanted to get more screenings in per day when Miramax released it. So the Oscar went to a shortened film, but the long version is here as well. Both of them looking absolutely beautiful. It's extraordinary. The longer version is only in Blu-ray. Mm. The 4K is the American release, the shortened release. So just know that going in, but still wonderful release from Arrow Academy, the art film brand of Arrow. The original Addams Family. which has been done animated again recently. This is theatrical and unrated versions. I'm not sure you need both of these in here. My one regret about this, Tim, tell me if you agree, is that Christopher Lloyd wound up playing Uncle Fester instead of John Lovitz.
That's almost a crime. And the thing of it is, they got to save money because with John Lovitz, you don't even need any makeup.
There you go.
Right there. He's standing right there.
Christopher Lloyd plays the grandfather, yeah, by the way, in the George Clooney film, The Tender Bar. You'll see that. Raul Julia, I'm sorry we lost him. He was so perfect for this. And you know, other than Christopher Lloyd, the casting was great. But man, John Lovitz would have been so much better than Christopher Lloyd. I'm so sorry that happened. Anyway, this has a digital code on it as well. It's not Movies Anywhere because it's Paramount, so it goes to Vudu or one of those other players. Also on 4K, Steelbook for Almost Famous.
Oh, yeah, man.
Wonderful. Won an Academy Award for Cameron Crowe for Best Original Screenplay. Very much the story of how he was a young journalist for Rolling Stone and kind of based on that experience. This is still a great film. I think it may even be Cameron Crowe's best film.
Oh, yeah.
Great Steelbook, 4K. Tons of extras here as well. You get the bootleg cut of the film and special features, plus the theatrical and the special features, both of them in 4K. So both of these versions, as long as we're talking about alternate versions, both of these versions are in 4K. And I don't know which one I necessarily like better, but there's just a ton of great extras on here. You know, all behind the scenes stuff, Cameron Crowe on how he made it, all kinds of great stuff. Jim Henson's Labyrinth. Let's talk about that for a second, Tim. We lost Bowie in that awful year where the music died. Yeah. George Michael, Bowie, and Prince all in the same year was just murder. I still can't believe we lost all three of those talents in the same year.
Yeah, man. Labyrinth. Unappreciated when it came out. What year was that? But became
boy. It's been 35 years, wow. So it's like what year would that have been?
What a
that's 89, something like
that. Yeah, yeah. But yeah. Become a cult classic since for all kinds of reasons, none the least of which David Bowie there. Fantastic, man.
Young Jennifer Lawrence looks terrific. Kind of a Jim Henson follow up to The Dark Crystal, which I still love The Dark Crystal, but Labyrinth took something of a different approach, and I think you're right. It's become kind of a cult classic, and it's still kicking, and that's why it's out on 4K Ultra HD and some interesting extras on here, which are mostly on Blu-ray, the deleted and alternate scenes and screen tests. That's all in HD, but everything else, all the other featurettes, they just left that in Blu-ray.
Yeah.
In the Heights, which do you like better? Do you like West Side Story or In the Heights better? I hate to compare them.
Why not? Let's do it anyway. West Side Story. I like better. We're talking about the new West Side Story, right? That's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
I like better. In the Heights, I appreciated at the time. It took a beat down for a bunch of stuff that I don't really give a damn about. So I still appreciate it. And in some ways, West Side Story, the current West Side Story, is doing a corrective about that whole sort of brown face thing. But this West Side Story, Steven's West Side Story, and so we're going to be doing a slam about this. Over at the site, so I won't blow everything right now on it. But yeah, that corrective it does. But I think he finds some additional gears too. It's an edgier, darker, scarier, meaner film. in a whole bunch of different ways. Except for those leads, they're slight, and that's interesting because they were slight in the 1961 film compared to everything and everyone else. They're slight. Adriana DeBose. Oh, wow. She plays Anita in this film. That was the role that Rita Moreno, who's also in this film, anyway, she's playing the role that Rita Moreno won that Oscar for.
Yeah.
Back in 61. And I got to tell you, this, I'm thinking she deserves it. She's good. She's a force, dude. She's just a force in this film. Aside from being ridiculously beautiful and having that voice, her dancing is just amazing. It's just like, you know, she's a whirlwind. She slayed me. Absolutely slayed me.
I have my own opinion about West Side Story, which I admit is a total minority opinion, but it will show up in the slam, which everyone will see at cinegods.com.
Yeah, let's go look.
But my sense was that West Side Story kind of wanted to be In the Heights, and In the Heights wants to be West Side Story.
Well, that's absolutely true. That's absolutely true.
But there are some wonderful things in the Heights. We talked about, you know, the Busby Berkeley biography, which is now in soft cover. There's definitely a tribute to Busby Berkeley in this as well, which I think is beautifully, beautifully done. So John Chu does quite a good job directing this. I think he took a little bit too much flack, but, you know. So a new one here from Disney, Tim, which I've been waiting for forever. Who Framed Roger Rabbit is out on 4K Ultra HD. Ooh. I loved this movie when it came out. I still love it. I think it looks amazing in 4K. This is the ultimate collector's edition. Has a Movies Anywhere code on it, so you can watch it over and over and ever. I still quote this movie, by the way. Having met Charles Fleischer, at one point, you kind of, you know, when you meet the man, the voice of Roger Rabbit, it changes your opinion of Roger Rabbit a little bit because he's a weird dude.
They're doing a two.
Are they? Yeah. Roger Rabbit 2?
Yeah, with Charles. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Well, this is an absolutely priceless classic. It looks phenomenal. It looks probably better than it looked when I saw it projected. They've done a wonderful job kind of combing over it and making all of the animation pop more, but also making everything around them pop more. So it feels almost to me like the integration of the animation with the live action environment works better now than it did before. Mm. Whatever they did, whatever digital tools they use, it's absolutely tremendous. This has extras on 4K, and then most of the extras are on Blu-ray. So the movie itself is absolutely spectacular. excuse me. It's got this thing on there called Ultra Play, where you can jump. It's a way of kind of jumping directly into the movie, and they've got an audio commentary. Amazing sound, but let me talk just for a second about some of the extras on here. So there's first of all the shorts. You know, there were other shorts that were done that were kind of that were not in the movie, but there were Roger Rabbit shorts. Those are also all on here. So don't worry about that. They're on Blu-ray. They're not in 4K. And then there's also behind the scenes stuff. The true story of Roger Rabbit. How they made it, how they actually integrated the animation with the live action. All of that stuff is absolutely spectacular. Very, very impressive. And I just want to put another shout out for the sound, which is Dolby Atmos. It's wonderful. If you have Dolby Atmos enabled on your system, it's immersive. It's absolutely totally immersive. I joked earlier about the No Time to Die subwoofer stuff. This actually is an amazing mix. No Time to Die is fine, but it's mostly just loud and booming. This is an amazing mix. People at Disney do a much better mix than almost anybody else when they mix it for the home environment. Krampus, the naughty cut. Did you ever see Krampus?
Too? Oh, yeah. You know, Krampus, the sort of, you know, angry Santa Claus.
Yeah, the Santa Claus is basically an angry demon. Yeah. I don't really understand what makes this cut different.
It was already obnoxious.
I'm not gonna try to figure it out. Anyway, the effects are good. I'll give them that. You know, they did down in Weta, where at Peter Jackson's old company, which just sold, by the way. He sold Weta.
I did not know that.
I'm sure he sold it for like over $1 billion.
Oh, wow.
I'm sure at some point he just probably said, you know what? That's too much money to turn down right now. And he took it. It's insane. Mm-hmm. Whatever he sold it for. Outrageous amount of money. A ton of extras on this thing, but it's still Krampus. That's the one thing you can't change. So the extras going to mean nothing if you're not just mad about Krampus.
Yeah.
But there it is. Let's see a few others that we've talked about before. We've talked about Quiet Place Part 2, yeah. 4K UHD, still definitely recommended as for gift Zack Snyder's Justice League on 4K. Mm-hmm. Let me point out, most things Warner Brothers come with a Movies Anywhere code. This does not, because they want you, if you're going to watch it streaming, they want you to watch it on HBO Max. So you don't get a code with this. You just get the disc. So just understand that. Zack Snyder's Justice League, which looks tremendous and is highly recommended. And I'm certainly going to back Ray Fisher for supporting actor when we vote. Mm-hmm.
New generation.
That too.
Yeah.
Could do that too. I mean, I want to give him something because, man, this would not exist if he hadn't been just a complete bitch on social media.
I mean,
he got out there and he just lit up a storm and now we get this.
Yeah.
Like, this is not Zack Snyder who made this happen. Ray Fisher made that movie happen. Yeah. So, Shawshank Redemption and Clockwork Orange also on 4K Ultra HD, both with Movies Anywhere codes. And, here's some new stuff. Here's the new stuff I really want to focus on. So first off, Kino has given us the Philip Kaufman Invasion of the Body Snatchers in 4K. Tim, which Body Snatchers is the better Body Snatcher?
Oh, man. There's the Abel Ferrar. And
the original Don Siegel
and the Philip Kaufman. I like the Abel Ferrar. I think Jeff Goldblum is in that.
And he
plays this sort of like obnoxious writer in that. And he has this line of dialogue where he's talking about how he chooses each word individually in his novels, which is why they don't sell. I think it's wonderful. Donald Sutherland, of course, playing the guy. I don't know. I mean, what do you think? What's your?
So there's actually a fourth one, which we all conveniently forget, which is the Oliver Hirschbiegel movie with Daniel Craig and Nicole Kidman. Yes. Which was not good, even though I love all of them. I've interviewed Hirschbiegel. I think he's super talented, but they took that movie away from him and they recut it. So there's probably a really interesting version of that movie that lives somewhere. I like the Abel Ferrar film a little bit because I was at Cannes the year that was there. And I remember the press conference when Abel Ferrar and the British journalist, whose name is slipping me right now, Alexander Walker, who, you know, once famous friend of Kubrick's, but where Abel Ferrar and Alexander Walker like got into it right in front of me. It was amazing. I'm like 10 feet away and Alexander Walker is like laying into Ferrar and Ferrar is laying into Walker and making fun of him. It was hilarious. But, I gotta say, if I'm given my choice, it's McCoffman. I gotta go with this one. It's Philip Kaufman before he was the right stuff. Philip Kaufman before he was the Henry in June and Unbearable Lightness of Being Phil Kaufman. He really made a great pivot in his career in 1978 before he was Phil Kaufman who co-created Indiana Jones. He pivoted in 1978 and did a remake of a film that was thought untouchable and classic and made it his own. Mm-hmm. And he, you know, Veronica Cartwright, who he would later use in the right.
And
stuff.
Actually, this is the one.
This is the one with Jeff Goldblum.
This is the one with Jeff Goldblum. Yes, go on.
And Donald Sutherland is so terrifying in this thing. I mean, it's very, very impressive. Screenplay, we need to point out, by W.D. Richter, who would go on to write Buckaroo Banzai.
Yeah.
So, I mean, how does it look? You know what? This is a movie that otherwise would be very 1970s. It would have a very 1970s sheen to it. But it doesn't here. The 4K is fantastic. It makes it vibrant and crisp, and it feels very contemporary. And that's, I think, one of the great things that the 4K is doing is that they're taking it away from the deteriorating print quality that a lot of movies in the 70s have now when you see them projected. and they're making it just live forever. It's wonderful. They load this up with extras. Phil Kaufman commentary, which is great. Steve Haberman commentary, which is great. Bunch of extras. There's an interview with Richter. There's an interview with Denny Zeitlin about the score. There's an interview with Art Hindle, just talking about the movie generally because he's an actor in the film. Stuff on special effects. It's just over and over. There's all the TV spots and radio spots that were used to market it. Great nostalgic stuff. Wonderful release. One of the best 4Ks of the season. Philip Kaufman's Invasion of the Body Snatchers from Kino Lorber. Absolutely terrific.
Yeah, I was conflating those two films. The Abel Ferrara was the one with Gabrielle Anwar and Arlie Ermey. And Meg Tilly and all. Yeah, which is still but not.
I conflate the Hirschbiegel and the Ferrara,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah.
I still conflate those. The other day I was mentioning this to somebody, and I said, because you remember when Daniel Craig was in that Abel Ferrara film, they're like, oh, no. Daniel Craig was in the other. I'm like, oh, it's easy because everything body snatches. Yeah. Everything body snatches in your head. Wolf of Wall Street is out on 4K. Yeah, I mean, how do we feel about that? I've gone back and forth on this film, Tim. Have you watched it again since it came
out? Not since it came out. You know, I was one of those who, for one thing, I remember that guy. I remember that guy from the 90s when he was roaming around Hollywood, trying to raise money. The guy that Leo plays in The Wolf of Wall Street, that movie did something that bugged me a little bit. It kind of set the guy up in a heroic light that I didn't care for. That guy ruined a lot of little old ladies. That guy was not a good guy. And Leo is charming and handsome and Margot Robbie and all of this. And, you know, when you came away from that movie, you know, thinking that this guy was some sort of this guy was just this creepy guy.
You raise a really interesting point, because Martin Scorsese has been followed by this his whole life, which is that he takes these really unsavory characters and almost puts them on a pedestal. Mm. That he doesn't, he admires them in all of their nastiness.
Wall Street, they're, you know, just Wall Street. That guy.
Goodfellas, The Irishman. That he kind of has he sort of admires these very unsavory figures. Not because he thinks they're good, but because he sort of likes the aesthetic that they represent, right? I think there's a little bit of that here. My problem in this movie is this movie's just too long. I think it's, I think the first half is fine cut. I think the second half is a mess, but a lot of people love this thing. It got a ton of Oscar nominations, and you know what? It's on 4K. So go
George
for it.
Milford. Not low. What was that guy's name? George Milford. That was his name. Yeah. Yeah.
And Tim, here we go. This is what we've come to for Christmas on 4K. The world has been waiting for the Criterion Collection to release its first 4K discs. Mm. And here they are. Mulholland Drive.
Ooh, David.
Widely considered the greatest film of this century still. Citizen Kane, often considered the greatest film ever made.
Last century for sure, yeah.
Uncut Gems, a movie that I don't think is very good at all, but I have a story to tell about this.
I like Uncut Gems.
Menace to Society, the Hughes brothers, who don't make movies together anymore. Let's first talk
about that movie. Yeah.
That's right. So let's talk about, what do you have any stories about Menace to Society?
Menace to Society, the Hughes brothers, that Hughes brothers film was at the time, what is it, 91, 92, something like that.
Oh, 93.
It gave us Lawrence Tate and a couple of other really, really amazing young African-American actors, and sort of launched the Hughes brothers' careers. They went on to do Dead Presidents and From Hell with Johnny Depp and a few other films. And it was a very, very intense film at that moment. And, you know, it was a little bit controversial, but I always thought it was a wonderful movie, that movie. Bridget plays a waitress in a Chinese restaurant in that movie. Love it, love it.
Well, we have all kinds of interesting connections to all these movies that we're going through. That's great. I'm going to have to take a second look at that. You got to tell me at what point she shows up.
It depends on which version of the movie you're watching anyway.
This is the 7.1 surround DTS audio is beautiful here. It's just beautiful. The 4K is absolutely terrific. A movie made in the 90s, you know, they all had a certain kind of a a steel sheen to them, and it continues to have that. It is absolutely a fantastic transfer. Really, really great extras here. Two commentaries from 1993, one with the Hughes brothers, and there's a selected scene commentary featuring Rinsler. And then it's just a lot of great stuff on here. I mean, there's a conversation between Albert Hughes, Tiger Williams, screenwriter, and Elvis Mitchell, who's always, you know, a great moderator for these things. It's just great stuff. Deleted scenes. It's really terrific. So Uncut Gems. I'm not a fan. I know a lot of people are. It's got a certain following. But here's what happened on my wife's birthday recently. Mm. So the restaurant that we like to always get stuff for her birthday was closed for a private event. They weren't answering the phone. I go down there. I know people are thinking, what does this have to do with Uncut Gems, the Safdie Brothers movie? Yeah. So I go down there, and it's like all discoed out, and they've got a DJ, and they're like, oh, you got a private event. I'm like, crap, what do I do? I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to go to our favorite little local Italian place and just, you know, grab some takeout food there. They know me. It's a great place. It's just, you know, I used to run to grab food there when my wife was pregnant and couldn't eat anything else. So I run. It's about 5 minutes from the other restaurant. So I head on over there. And I walk in, and while I'm there waiting to give my order, Adam Sandler walks in and picks up some takeout. And I didn't fully process it was Adam Sandler, because we're all wearing masks still,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
And I didn't even fully process it was Adam Sandler until the waiter who brings the food out is looking all over here, like at my 2 o'clock, is looking all nervous. And I kind of like, oh, what's he? And he comes, he brings the food, and he goes, you know, my daughter in daycare, she sings your Hanukkah song all the time, and they just love it so much. And then I hear that familiar voice going, oh, that's great to know. Thank you very much. And I was like, oh, son of a God, it's Adam Sandler. And I'm like, I felt sorry for him, because like you don't go to pick up food only. It's a nice compliment, but it's like this guy just wants to get his food, right? So then I grab, you know, our food, and I walk on back across the street, and son of a God, Adam Sandler and his friend are getting into his car, and these girls in front of the yogurt shop are like getting into it with him. And he's like, oh yeah, thank you. And like, this poor guy cannot walk 10 feet without somebody, like without fan service, just, you know, it's like, man, that's why they don't go out.
Yeah.
That's why celebrities don't go out. In any case, I don't like the movie, but boy, I like Adam Sandler. So I'm going to recommend Uncut Gems.
Anyway. What can I say? I like the Safdie Brothers. I like that movie. Intense movie. That movie opens at 80 miles an hour, and then applies the gas all the way through.
All the way through, man. Then Citizen Kane, man, there's nothing I can tell you about Citizen Kane you'd already know. I mean, look, it's considered the greatest film ever made. This is an absolutely wonderful 4K transfer. It's phenomenal. You can watch this on HBO Max, but it doesn't look nearly as good. Doesn't even come close. And I did that. I compared them the other day. This is the only way to watch Citizen Kane. All due respect to HBO Max. They got to step up their game with that transfer. Yeah. There's a new program on here with Craig Barron and Ben Burtt, legendary Ben Burtt of Sound Guy, that is very, very cool. And you get, you know, interviews and behind the scenes stuff. You can literally spend 5 hours with this and the extras and not get tired. And it'll be a film education, and you will never see this film or the world the same way again. Absolutely gorgeous. I cannot praise this high enough. And then lastly, David Lynch's Mulholland Drive.
Man.
So, as I have mentioned many, many times, my wife was working for David Lynch at the time. Now, this movie was originally a television pilot that was too long, and ABC vetoed it. They paid for the pilot and then said, we don't want to make the show. And then one day, when my wife was there with everybody else on staff, and they're just kind of hanging out and doing whatever, and David comes blowing through the sliding glass door and says, I've got it. I figured it out. It's a dream. And he had reconceptualized Mulholland Drive and went back and rewrote it, and they shot some new stuff and recut the movie, and it wound up becoming this classic that you have before you, and it's now 4K from Criterion. And let me just say, there's a scene late in the movie where Naomi Watts is in the cafe, and she opens the bag of money and puts her hand in.
Mm-hmm.
That shot of her hand going into the bag is not her hand. That hand is my wife.
We have the most Thank bizarre.
I know, we have funny stories, don't we?
Ridiculous.
It was a pickup shot. It was a bit, and to this day, my wife says, she goes, I've been directed by
David. Because it's true.
It's true. Very, very happy with that. So in any case, really absolutely terrific. Wonderful interviews here with a lot of people who worked on the film, including Naomi Watts, Justin Theroux, Angela Badalamenti, Jack Fisk, the production designer who's been with David Lynch since Eraserhead, because Lynch's first wife was Fisk's sister, and casting director Joanna Ray, whom I know and who is an absolutely wonderful person, mm-hmm. and she's just great here. Look, I don't know what else you can say about this. It's the first David Lynch film to really get the 4K. Criterion treatment. I'm thrilled it's one of the first four, and there it is. It's just absolutely great. Yeah. Just great. Tim, shall we wrap things out then with the giant box sets? A lot of these we've covered. We can go through these pretty quickly in our last half hour.
Yeah, here.
So
Definitely going to want to know what's in that Richard Pryor collection
and what's
in that Wong Kar-wai collection.
So before we get to that, Arrow has a bunch of box sets and then one really cool movie that we just should recommend. My Stepmother is an Alien is the movie. Dan Aykroyd and Kim Basinger, really underrated. This movie is really fun. I used to hate it. Now I watch it. I have kind of a lot of nostalgic joy with it. So I think this movie is a hoot. Kim Basinger has kind of disappeared from the scene. And that's too bad because I still think she's a great actress and I'd love to see her come back and do something. My Stepmother is an Alien, really, really fun from Arrow. Consider that as a gift. Here are the big box sets from Arrow. Mill of the Stone Women by Giorgio Ferroni. This is sort of a giallo film, but it's a nice two-disc limited edition. It's got some great extras on it. And it's got, you know, French and U.S. versions as well. It's famous as the first Italian horror film that was ever shot in color. Mm. So, I mean, you know, it's influential on that regard. It also goes along with the two Giallo Essentials volumes that have been released, which include The Possessed, The Fifth Chord, Torso, What Have They Done to Your Daughters, Strip Nude for Your Killer. You know, a lot of and The Pajama Girl Case. Those are the movies between these two great volumes. You should get them both together for anybody who's a big Giallo fan. Giallo Essentials from Arrow, two big volumes. Phantom of the Mall, Eric's Revenge, mm-hmm. another horror film. Not exactly a holiday thing, but it's a nice boxed set. Really, really, you know, worth it. It's got a lot of kind of grungy 80s era stuff in it. It's a good cult film. And then the last two from the world of Japanese cinema, highly recommended, two of the best box sets that Arrow has ever released. We've covered this before. The Daimajin trilogy is really, really terrific. Daimajin, Return of Daimajin, and Wrath of Daimajin. It's pretty great. Good Japanese monster stuff. And then Shohei Imamura's The Survivor Ballads, box set that includes his Ballad of Narayama, which won the Cannes Film Festival, plus Zigen and Black Rain, which is also famous. Mm. Shohei Imamura, one of the great all-time Japanese filmmakers. That is the boxed set stuff from Arrow. All highly, highly recommended. Definitely check those out. And then, yeah, let's talk about the Richard Pryor collection. We've talked about that before, man. That is just an unbelievable set. It's TV appearances, it's guest show spots, it's the concert films, it's all that. Plus the Virgil Films documentary, I Am Richard Pryor. So it's from Time Life and Virgil together. It's a wonderful, wonderful collection. And we raved about this before. And this is still, you know, one of the, I mean, if you're going to make a list of the sort of the top five stand-up comedy icons in the history of American comedy, Pryor is going to be right there at the top. Yeah. I mean, he changed everything. And even Dave Chappelle will say that. There's no Dave Chappelle without Richard Pryor.
Oh, yeah. There's no Eddie Murphy, no Martin Lawrence, no Dave Chappelle. It's just, yeah. There you go.
Yeah. So Richard Pryor, the ultimate Richard Pryor collection, Uncensored. Absolutely one of the best box gifts you could do all season. From the film Detective, they got a really cool set here, the Sherlock Holmes Vault Collection, four classic mysteries that they have put into this wonderful box. Sherlock Holmes Fatal Hour, The Triumph of Sherlock Holmes, Silver Blaze, and A Study in Scarlet. And you also get some, Sherlock shorts in here, things like Sherlock Holmes Baffled from 1900. You get Sherlock Holmes from 1928, Cousins of Sherlocko, 1913. So a lot of really, they're like nice little ephemera there, little trivia type stuff. So it's good. It's good. This is the kind of stuff that you get from the film Detective. You know, it's archival and it's fun stuff.
Yeah, some of that stuff goes back far enough to Conan Doyle was still alive.
It's true. Yeah. He was alive with some of when they were adapting some of that stuff in the silent era for sure. Wonderful 10 Best Picture, as long as we're getting into Oscar season, 10 Best Picture box set, which includes Titanic, Forrest Gump, No Country for Old Men, Terms of Endearment, The Godfather, Gladiator, The English Patient, American Beauty, Wings, and My Fair Lady. It's a wonderful set from Paramount. It's just great movie
best
stuff.
Pictures, all best genres, pictures, right?
All yeah, best pictures. Yeah. It's terrific. Lee Isaac Chung is a good friend of our friend, Justin Chang. And he became a multiple Oscar nominee recently with Minari. Yeah. And now everybody's revisiting all his old movies. And Film Movement has released a boxed set of three of his earlier films. Munyurungavo. Mm-hmm. I always muck that up. Lucky Life and Abigail Harm with Amanda Plummer doing one of her best ever performances. Yeah. So these three movies are just delightful. They don't come loaded up with extras, but they are really, really good films. And if you're a Lee Isaac Chung fan, if you saw Minari and said, "Where's this filmmaker been my whole life?" Well, now you can get these three films in a box set from Film Movement.
Nothing like a hit.
You can. That's right. Nothing like a hit to make people rediscover your stuff. Also, a wonderful Sergei Eisenstein double feature box, which is DVD only, not Blu-ray, but DVD only, Alexander Nevsky and October, two of the great all-time Eisenstein films. Those are in a new box set from Corinth Films and Image Entertainment, and both of them are great and absolutely worth discovering if you're a big film
buff.
Tim, let me get this these two other Paramount things out of the way here. We got a John Wayne 14 movie collection.
Oh, wow.
Which has it's got a ton of stuff in it. I mean, you got to be this is also in Paramount. You got to be a real hardcore John Wayne fan, because a lot of this stuff is just straight up. It's like so much testosterone. You might choke on it. Big Jake, McClintock, Donner's Reef, Rio Lobo, Hondo, The Shootist, Hatari, El Dorado, The High and the Mighty, True Grit. I mean, all these titles just tell you it's like tough stuff. Sons of Katie Elder. That's the one that sounds a little softer. Man Who Shot Liberty Valance. But it's a nice box set.
The thing about John did a lot of it. John was a movie star in more genres than almost anybody else that I can think of. John, obviously the Western, obviously the war movie, but John did comedies, did light comedy. John did later in his career rough urban cops. John was not just a cowboy. John cowboy movies. No. John did movies, man, all kinds of movies, you know.
Well, who else did all kinds of movies? Yeah. Jerry Lewis. No, not really. Jerry Lewis just makes Jerry Lewis movies. But this is another box set from Paramount, which is absolutely great. Also DVD, not Blu-ray, but all so much fun. 20 Jerry Lewis movies in one box set. This will drive people either crazy. It'll drive some people insane. But a lot of people like me.
Me too.
I could sit there and watch this for days on end.
Would you?
Hollywood or Bust, The Delicate Delinquent, Cinderfella, The Bellboy, The Errand Boy, Nutty Professor, The Patsy, Disorderly Orderly, Family Jewels, The Caddy, Scared Stiff, Jumping Jack, Sailor Beware. I mean, this is awesome. Yeah. This is just what Artists and Models is even on here. That's never been out on a DVD before. So Artists and Models with Shirley MacLaine to crying out. Shirley MacLaine and Jerry Lewis in a movie together.
Yeah.
People forget that happened.
Yeah.
So much fun.
What's interesting about a lot of those movies, nearly all of those movies, are sort of sex comedies. A lot of those
movies. That's true.
So sort of really targeted sex. And in the context are fairly lurid. And a lot of those movies are like The Apartment, you know, I mean, people think about the context of The Apartment is fairly lurid. But in some ways we've become much more, quaint's not the right word, but than we were 35, 40, 50, 60 years ago. Interesting.
And I'm going to make a couple. There's a couple of movie star collections here. 12 movie collections, both of them. One is the Randolph. I'm always talking about John Wayne. Randolph Scott collection. 12 classic westerns. Randolph Scott did tons of westerns. There's some really good movies in here. There's Santa Fe, The Tall T, Buchanan Rides Alone. I mean, they're all pretty standard westerns, but they're really, really fun.
And Randolph, unlike John Wayne, pretty much only made westerns.
That's all he did. He knew better than to try to stretch. And then I am, of course, a legendary Rita Hayworth fan for many reasons. Yeah. Rita Hayworth, the first major Latina movie star, even though nobody really paid attention to that fact. But her dad was the dancing instructor at my father's acting school. And, I'm very proud of that. And my father was Rita Hayworth's very first actor.
That's fantastic. So
I take a certain degree of family pride in that, but this is a wonderful 12 film collection. She's sort of the great female movie star of all time. Lady from Shanghai, Orson Welles, Pal Joey, Salome, Music in My Heart, Affair in Trinidad, The Loves of Carmen, Miss Sadie Thompson, Down to Earth, the movie that basically inspired Xanadu. A lot of people don't know that. Mm-hmm. So it's really...
No Gilda?
Gilda is not in this one. Well, gotta get Gilda separately.
Okay.
Yeah, gotta get Gilda separately. Tim, let's talk about the Wong Kar-wai set.
Oh, yes, please.
We've talked about this previously, but these are his polished re-edits. They are, a little bit different. If you have some of these films in their previous releases, you might want to hang on to them because the cuts are a little different in some cases. But the films As Tears Go By, Days of Being Wild, Chungking Express, Fallen Angels, Happy Together, In the Mood for Love, and 2046. Yeah. An amazing set. Really, his films are... Did I ever tell you the quote that I got from him? It was hilarious. I was interviewing him at Cannes around the time of Happy Together. And I can't even remember what the question was that I asked him, but it had something to do with his working process. And he looks at me with those freaking sunglasses. We're indoors, man. It's night. We're indoors. And he's wearing the damn sunglasses. And he says to me, and he goes, most people, they write the movie, then they shoot the movie, and then they edit the movie. And then he grins like that Cheshire freaking cat that he is. And he says, I do all three at the same time. I'm like, you son of a bitch. Don't give me that. And that was his answer. I do all three at the same time. He just loves messing with people.
Yeah. Wong Kar-wai. Fantastic.
Anyway. Yeah. Wonderful. So, buddy, if you do happen to have, for example, Chungking Express in the previous edition, it's a little different cut. Hang on to it. Hang on to the other one, so you have all the completeness. Also, speaking of Criterion and Asian cinema, we have Once Upon a Time in China, the complete films. This is a fantastic box set of all the Once Upon a Time in China films. 1, 2, and 3 that all starred Jet Li, and then 4 and 5, which did not. And then tucked away in the extras is Once Upon a Time in China and the West, which brought Jet Li back to the franchise. Now, I'm going to tell a story here for the first time, which I feel we have enough distance from the movie for me to talk about this, because the Hong Kong New Wave is basically over. It's the 1990s. Mm. So it's around whatever year it was, 97, I guess, again. It's the same year as Happy Together. So 97, I'm at the American Film Festival, American Film Market, sorry. American Film Market.
Over in Santa Monica.
And I saw Once Upon a Time in China in the West, which was produced by Wynns, not by Golden Harvest. And I thought, well, that's funny. Jet Li came back to the franchise, but it's now no longer Golden Harvest film. So I go down and I'm talking to the executive, very famous executive, successful executive with Golden Harvest. And I said to her, you mind if I ask, you guys, this is one of your franchise your main franchises. Why would you let this go? I mean, you gave it to Wins. What's the story there? And I wasn't thinking in my head, because Wins was run by the Hung brothers at the time, who are famous triad mobsters in Hong Kong, right? They're still around, by the way. A lot of mob money in Hong Kong movies. And the Hung brothers, you know, badasses, really scary guys. And Charles Hung especially. And I said to her, why don't you let it go? And she says, we value our heads. And she wasn't joking. She wasn't joking. So somebody went to Golden Harvest and basically threatened them and said, we want to make a Once Upon a Time in China movie and with Jet Li, and you're going to let us do it. And they're like, okay. True story. I swear to you, true story. It's crazy. Anyway, it's all here. You got to get it. I mean, these movies have been out before, but never in Blu-ray, never looking this good. And the fact that we're getting some, you know, real Hong Kong New Wave movies on Criterion is a gift and a godsend. Finishing off things, Tim, I want to show you something. I went nuts to get this. This is not something anyone will be able to get in time for Christmas, but I'm going to recommend it anyway. This is not available in the United States. And what I'm talking about, what I'm showing Tim right now, is called Collaborations, the Cinema of Zhang Yimou and Gong Li. This is from the Australian company Imprint. They're kind of like the Australian version of Criterion and Arrow. We have never had a relationship with these people. We do now because Zhang Yimou's movies have been horribly, horribly represented in the United States on Blu-ray. They almost don't exist. The Shanghai Triad was recently released on Blu-ray from Cohen. Thank you, Cohen. They're the only ones that have really done right by it. His Oscar-nominated Red Sorghum and Judo and Raise the Red Lantern, these movies have never been out. Story of Xu Zhu is only on DVD. Curse of the Golden Flower has been out in kind of a standard Blu-ray from Sony. Coming Home was never really treated that well. These guys at Imprint went to town. They did an amazing thing. They said, you know what? There's a market for this. They've created this unbelievable box set. Collaborations, the Cinema of Zhang Yimou and Gong Li, with Red Sorghum, Judo, Raise the Red Lantern, The Story of Xu Zhu, To Live, the amazing To Live, maybe his best film, Shanghai Triad, Curse of the Golden Flower, and Coming Home, all in this amazing, beautiful box, which you can order online, and it will take about 6 weeks to get to you. But it is spectacular. And I'm opening the box right now. They all come in their own individual keep cases, and there's a booklet. And all on Blu-ray. The transfers are gorgeous, and the movies are epic and legendary. Zhang Yimou, maybe my favorite filmmaker in the world right now, and especially Coming Home, this beautiful film that he made just a few years ago that has one of the most heartbreaking scenes you'll ever see in a movie in it. I cannot praise this set enough, and I'm gonna you're gonna look for this on the website. We're gonna have a separate gift guide on the website. I'll include links on how to snatch that. Our two last box sets is the Audrey Hepburn 7 movie collection, Tim, that we previously talked about. That's got Breakfast at Tiffany's, Funny Face, My Fair Lady, Paris When It Sizzles, Roman Holiday, Sabrina, and War and Peace. How do you not get this for somebody who loves Audrey Hepburn?
Are you kidding me? Yeah. That beautiful classic photograph of Audrey Hepburn against that Tiffany's pink on the cover.
Oh, gosh.
Breathtaking.
Oh. And then the last one, I need to know if you think anybody is going to want to buy this. And that's not slamming this. It's just, this is a brick. The Middle Earth 31 disc Ultimate Collector's Edition. Every version of the Hobbit and Lord of the Rings movies ever.
Oh yeah.
Two versions a piece.
How many discs again?
31 discs.
Yeah, the answer is yes. There absolutely are people who will have to have that good play. That's the 4K everything.
4K everything.
All features that have ever been on any of the discs previously.
All the features, all the movies, all the versions of the movies, all also on Blu-ray and on 4K and with Movies Anywhere.
Yeah.
Codes.
Oh yeah.
And the extras, when you do the math and you figure out the movies, you figure, okay, that's 6 movies. That's 18 hours for the original, kind of the original cuts. Mm-hmm. Then that's like 25 or 26 hours with the extended cuts. So now we're over 40 hours. Mm-hmm. And then we have extras, which are also like 40 hours. So literally, I could sit around for 3 days of not sleeping and not even make it through every second of everything that's in this box.
Yeah. Yeah, but yes,
freaking unbelievable.
Yes, people will. Yes, there are some completists who will have that. Absolutely.
Wow.
And good on them. Do it. Do it.
This is the mother gift of all gifts. And Tim, you see what this sticker says here? I'm going to make you feel really old because I wanted to cry when I saw this. Lord of the Rings, 20th anniversary.
It burns.
Oh, my God. Sucks, right? I know. Well, that's it for our show. And we're gonna take you out with some more Blackmore's Night. And otherwise, Tim, I don't know what can we say to people to send them off well for their second pandemic holiday season.
Well, things are better than they were last year. They actually are. And I think that we should recognize that because it's literally true. Do what you got to do. And things will be better still as we move on. But things are better than they were last year.
I will take that. And I hope everyone else does too. Tim, have an absolutely incredibly Merry Christmas. Are you're heading home?
No, going to stick it out here for awesome. Christmas. Celebrated some Hanukkah with some friends last week. Hanukkah was like last week or what? Came early this year. But I'll be here. I just went home for Thanksgiving, so that's good. And there you go. I took a trip home, got back safe and sound. That's good enough. We're fine. We're fine. I'll see my mom.
All right. Well,
you guys have fun.
We will, and maybe we'll head over to your neck of the woods and try to see you during the holidays. We're going to try to get out and see some.
Sounds good.
So,
sounds good, baby.
Yeah. All right. And to all of our listeners, have a great, great Christmas season. We might do one more cleanup show before the end of the year, but if we don't, we'll see you in 2022. Merry Christmas and happy holidays, everybody. When the snow lay round about, deep and crisp and even, brightness shone home at night, though the frost was cruel. When a poor man came in sight, gathering winter fuel. Hear the page and stand by me, most it telling, yon the peasant, who is he, where and what his dwelling? Sir, he lives a goodly glens underneath the mountain, right against the forest bend.